A very good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from Pauline McNeill and Sharon Dowie is joining us online. So today we're beginning our stage one evidence taking on the Police Ethics Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. So before I begin, I wish to declare that I was a former police officer for Grampian Police and Police Scotland. And can I invite any other members to declare any interests that they have? Russell Finlay.
Yeah, in my past job as a journalist, I spoke with Stephanie Bonner and indeed Bill Johnson, one of the other witnesses today, and Magdalene Robertson.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Don't know if there are any other members who wish to make a declaration. Okay, thank you very much indeed. So I welcome to the meeting Ms. Stephanie Bonner and I refer members to papers 1 to 4. So it's vitally important that we hear the views of those who have personal experience of the police complaints system. The committee is very interested to hear your perspective on what is being proposed in the bill. So I intend to allow around about 45 minutes for this evidence session. So I wonder, just by way of opening things up, if I can perhaps ask you a question, Stephanie, and it's a fairly simple one. Can I ask what you think should be changed about the police complaint system based on your own experience?
Well, excuse me, could I read an opening statement, if you don't mind, please? I've prepared.
Of course.
Justice Committee, I wish to make this short statement to help the committee before taking questions. Indeed, hopefully this statement will cover some of your questions. I want to explain how difficult it can be to make a serious complaint against Police Scotland. In my case, it took over 6 months from the discovery of my son's body to actually making a formal complaint against the police. My firstborn, my 19-year-old son, Rhys Bonner, was discovered on the 8th August 2019. A formal complaint was made against Police Scotland on the 6th of March 2020. During this period, Police Scotland took me on a journey and I experienced many of their tactics first-handed. I can only describe this journey as a hellish memory go-round of distractions, deceit, deception and manipulation, in the hope that I would overcome my grief and simply go away. Rhys's body was discovered on a Thursday, the 8th of August 2019. The police closed their investigation on Monday, the 12th of August 2019. That's 4 days later, or one full working day later, but they never told me this. They led me on and on and on. Every time I mentioned making a complaint, they would stall me or distract me, and at one point they sent female officers out to try and connect me and to befriend me and groom me. This is the type of tactics that don't leave a clear trail of evidence. Then when I asked Mr. O'Kane to represent me in February 2020, Police Scotland refused to put a mandate in place for him. They told him in writing that the investigation was still ongoing despite it being closed 6 months earlier. So in my case, it wasn't that easy for me to even start the complaints process. It makes me wonder how many other grieving families have experienced the same obstructions and manipulation and are prevented from making complaints. I know of other parents who have simply been overwhelmed by grief and have had no strength to engage with the police complaints process. Whilst I am the voice of my son, I am determined to give other parents and other families voices too. What does it feel like to make a serious complaint against Police Scotland? Some of you may have watched the TV series Mr. Bates versus the police office. One man's battle against a huge organisation. One man's battle to uncover the truth. My representative, Mr. O'Kane, has used this type of compassion. He calls my journey Mrs. Bonner versus Police Scotland. Make no mistake, Police Scotland was hell-bent in making my life difficult. They didn't want complaints made. They didn't want me to have a representation, as they know it was easier to manipulate a grieving mother. Indeed, this month, Park upheld 2 complaints I made. One was regarding the police continually contacting me whilst being specifically told not to. The other was regarding the police sending a marked police van to Mr O'Kane's home with a number of uniformed officers simply to deliver a letter, which we acknowledged an email has he sent. This was part of a course of action to try and intimidate me and my representative. At one point in time, police officers put hands on me and my representative hands on me and gave me a written warning to try and stop my campaign, to stop me campaigning for justice for my son. This, in other words, I was threatened with the force of the law in an attempt to silence me from raising genuine concerns. Five of these concerns, including failings to properly investigate the death of my son, have been upheld by Park Review. After the initial manipulation, misinformation, deceit and grooming failed, and an official complaint was made on my behalf, Mr Kane and I then encountered Police Scotland's wall of silence as they close ranks to protect each other. It's a culture you may have read or heard about in the media over the years, but if you have experienced it, you will feel how cold and calculated it is. I made two complaints which were interlinked. The first complaint, which was made in March 2020, the second complaint, which was made in 2022, but put on hold by Police Scotland and Park due to similar points. It has taken over 4 years to exhaust the police and Park complaints process. It has taken over four long and painful years just to prove that my son's death was not properly investigated by Police Scotland. Potentially vital evidence was lost forever, and I will never know what happened to my son. I will never know with certainty why my son's body was discovered due to two different sets of coordinates held by Police Scotland and conflicting accounts and video footage that I secured from local people. Police Scotland have put me through a prolonged and unnecessary nightmare, and I have lost all faith in them and their complaint process. Police Scotland have also repeatedly given quotes to the media suggesting that they are working closely with me, communicating with me and supporting me. This was painful to read, as this could not be further from the truth. I wanted justice for my son. These people have asked me what justice looks like. I am looking at justice right now. I am looking at the Justice Committee and the changes you might bring to policing. Police Scotland has to be reformed, and I am relieved that the Justice Committee has taken on this task. Thank you.
Okay, Stephanie, thank you very much for such comprehensive opening remarks. I think that really sets the scene for us very, very helpfully and very openly. I wonder if I can just ask you about the sort of how important having a representative support you through your journey has been to you. Now, it's slightly straying off perhaps the provisions of the bill, but that obviously was a very important aspect of your journey. So I wonder if you can maybe just outline a little bit more about how important that was to have that there by your side.
More than the world. Mm. My voice, he says I'm the voice. Alex O'Kane is my voice. He's my son's voice. He has made me. I might shed tears every day. I've cried a wall and a wall of tears. But that man and his wife have made me. I'm so proud to hold my head high, and they've just made me so strong. Mm-hmm. And they said, I was not losing my mind. That was it's happening. It was happening.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for that. Safety. And I think that really did come through loud and clear in your opening remarks. Before I bring in other members, one of the other things I'd like to touch on is delays and the timescales that you've experienced in since your son was discovered.
I'll get mixed up there. That's fine. On you go.
Not at all. So I'm really just wanting to ask you a little bit about how difficult those timescales have been for you, and what should we be considering when we're looking at the bill about how that aspect to a police inquiry or review can be improved?
See, the first answer, I didn't answer that one. I just gave it myself and it was dropped down. Can I do the first one again, please, if you don't mind?
Yes, that's fine.
What do you think should be changed about police complaint system based on your experience? You never asked me that one. It was just about Alex O'Kane, wasn't it? So I wasn't put off guard. Right, my second one is, it took Police Scotland the best part of a year to investigate one complaint. Then it took Park the best part of the next year to review the complaint. It was clear that Park did not have access to all the information they needed, and they repeatedly had to contact the police specific documents. Park were clearly delayed by the situation and were dependent on the police in terms of timescales. This left me waiting and prolonged my pain and distress. Police Scotland did not want to engage with me as soon as I had made a formal complaint, so I couldn't ask other relevant questions about my son's death as I faced a wall of silence. This left me unable to lay flowers at the location where my son's body was discovered. I still don't know with certainty where my son's body was discovered, as Police Scotland told two different sets of coordinates. They eventually said one set was a mistake, so I don't know what to believe now. I have been left traumatised by this and I have lost all faith in Police Scotland.
Okay, thank you, Stephanie. Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in other members to ask questions now. I'm going to bring in Fulton McGregor to start off.
Hey, thanks, Convener, and good morning, Stephanie.
Good morning.
To those that are supporting you, thank you very much for what was a very, very powerful testimony there. And in bringing your sons, in your case, to the Justice Committee. I've got just a very small question. It's not actually one that's that would have been on the sheet handed out to you, so I hope it's okay to ask, but it's about this issue that you've raised about the legal representation and how you felt that was kind of pushed back in that, which somewhat surprised me when I heard that. So do you think that perhaps something this bill could do or even look at, do you think it would be helpful if when somebody is at the start of a complaint process like that, the police actually sit down and actually advise you to get legal advice?
I'll answer this. It is vital to remember that the police are being asked to investigate themselves. So unlike when they're asked to investigate criminals, they're investigating some of their own. So there will be a lack of willingness. I don't believe that there is any way to avoid this whilst the police are being asked to investigate themselves. So the sooner Park or other more independent and objective bodies become involved, the better. The head of complaints form is problematic as it is asked to surmise a lengthy complaint into a small box. The categorisation of complaint is confusing as members of the public might not understand. If the complaint has been correctly categorised, the time of the police takes to investigate a complaint has to be reasonable. Then the time Park takes is often dependent on the files made available to them by the police. In my case, Park had to repeatedly ask police officers for more documents and this took more time. It's taken me over 4 years to have 20 complaints investigated and reviewed by Park. Yes, there's Police Scotland don't give you nothing to work with at all. Don't give you any guidance.
So do you think it would have been helpful for you and perhaps others in a similar situation if at that very early stage police officers or people within the police were actually advising you to get legal advice?
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
And were supportive of that? And would
somebody show it. I've never been shown any empathy, no compassion, no nothing. So I've just never had experience of anything from them like that. But it would be great if they could be like that obviously, for other families in the future.
Okay,
thank you. I've never got that. I've been like any other family gift that. No, loved one's just been in the circumstances.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Stephanie.
Okay, thank you. Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Stephanie. Thanks morning. For coming and
thank you
for being so brave today.
Thank you.
It's just a quick question, and it's basically to say before you had to put in a complaint, which you clearly had to do, would a single point of contact for you been helpful? You know, after your son's body was discovered?
Pardon?
You had a single point of contact. In other words, you know...
The same person?
Yeah,
definitely. You get a wee bit of faith in them and things, and you get to know them and it makes you comfortable.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Okay. Right.
Especially having the wee kids and that as well, because I don't the police officers, all the different ones came in and the way they were, I was scared for my kids.
Yeah, exactly. And was there a difference in police attitude after you took the complaint out to before that? I mean, I know from what you're saying, there was very poor communication even before that, and that's why you ended up having to... But did you find it got more...
Yes, see, when my son was missing and the police officers had come and just asked you for your photos and different things and meet your boy, they were all lovely, so they were so compassionate at the start. And I feel as if when the other ones were coming in and things, that's when I was getting scared. Uh-huh. And I said, could you look for my boy and things? And they're talking about resources, and I didn't know what that means. And I'm saying to my partner, what does that mean about money? I went, oh, please, put money into my boy, get a helicopter, sniffer dogs, things.
Uh-huh. Which you shouldn't have had to do.
Yeah, and they wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
Okay. I begged and begged.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Katie Clark.
Yes, thank you. And thank you, Stephanie, for being so brave as to come along today. It must be incredibly difficult. And from what you've said to Rona, it sounds as if you didn't have a single point of contact. You had quite a number of individuals that you had to deal with. And that clearly is quite a major issue. But one of the issues that we were wanting to ask you about was the duty of candour, because one of the things in this bill is to put in a duty of candour. Do you feel there was candour from the police in your situation? Do you feel that would make a difference?
What question was that?
It's question, I don't know if you have it, is 22. I'm not sure how it's numbered for you.
No, I've got...
But it's more, I think probably the question five. Whether you feel there was sort of openness from the police when you were, you know...
No.
So in terms of your experience, you didn't feel...
Yes. No, sadly, I don't think a creation of duty of candour requirement will be enough. You're asking police officers who stand shoulder to shoulder with each other and may literally protect each other's backs in dangerous situations to be truthful and cooperative, which could lead to their colleagues being disciplined and punished. They protect each other every working day, so they are most likely going to protect each other in these types of situations. Okay. Perhaps giving evidence under oath with a perjury-type system in place might make officers more willing to cooperate. There has to be consequences in place if they don't cooperate or they are proven to be untruthful. If police officers are held more accountable, they may be in confidence. The public confidence might increase.
Thank you. And I mean, it looks as if you've done a lot of preparation for today. Would you be happy to share maybe whatever, you know, anything in writing that you've prepared with us, if we haven't already got that, would you be...
Yes, I've just prepared the answers to the questions.
Yes, that would be really helpful if you could afterwards.
That's number five, isn't it?
But it's quite clear that you feel that there wasn't that candour or honesty.
Oh, no, definitely,
100%.
Thank
you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can just ask you a question about PERC, Stephanie, number 23. I wonder if you could tell us what you think about the introduction of a legal requirement for Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority to respond to recommendations that are made by PERC after they've handled a review, after they've dealt with a review. So do you have a thought on that at all? Just...
Yes, absolutely.
Maybe question six.
Question six, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Got them mixed up. Question six. What do you think? Question six, what do you think? There's question six.
Don't worry if you don't have that to hand. You can easily...
I think this could be helpful. This may require Police Scotland and the SPA to look closer at PERC review findings and recommendations.
Okay, that's very helpful. Can I bring in any other members at all? Russell Finlay, do you want to come in?
Thank you. Hi, Stephanie, how are you doing? I want to pay tribute to you for coming in here today. None of us can really truly imagine what you've been through. And it's, you know, admirable that you want to do this in order to help other families going forward. Now, if it's okay, don't worry too much about the numbered questions. I'd just quite like to ask a general question to start with, and what this experience has done, both in respect of your faith in policing and indeed all the supporters you have here today, yeah. Their faith in policing.
It's just there's no faith. Right. You could read that. Sorry,
can that? Do you think that can be repaired?
Yes. I think it. In the future, as things put in place and things, it could be repaired, and hopefully other families will be able to, in the future, not go through this, and it could be.
Yeah. Now, when we spoke in 2020, I was working at STV News at the time, and one of the issues that you raised at that point was the initial catastrophic mistakes made by the police may have been due to what was deemed to be postcode policing.
Uh-huh.
And assumptions were made, and at that point, having made their decisions, there was no going back from that.
There's no going back. That's.
And then when you attempted to get answers, you effectively had to conduct your own investigation, which the percolator established to be the case.
Yeah.
But I suppose that all of this was compounded by the complaints process, which is what we're looking at today. So could you just explain the tactics, or you've already done so, but we've got delays, we've got the mischaracterisation of heads of complaint, we've got attempts to put pressure on you. How would you summarise the entire complaints process? What did it do to you, and how did it make you feel?
If I never had my represented, it's okay. And it's just designed to break you. It's absolutely designed to break you. It's a very hard complaint system. It's really,
they've got the resources and the arguments, and they know the system.
I think CIS Professional Standards Department, that was really a big farce, and that was a horrible experience. So it was, especially as that the Professional Standards Department right at the start, that was awful.
Because making a complaint as a member of the public about something that's happened is one thing, but you're a grieving mother, and you're complaining about something that's absolutely unimaginable to most people. And there was no real compassion, apart from at the outset, where the officers came to you and were respectful and helpful. But after that, it just became, I think the phrase you used was, a hellish merry-go-round. And that seems to sum it up.
It's just I'm getting mixed up with the numbers.
Don't worry about the written numbers. It's just about how you feel and just remembering some of what happened, you know? But
I couldn't believe that this was our Police Scotland, and I'm begging for help, and I couldn't believe it. Lost all faith. I've lost all faith, and I don't think it could be restored by this point.
We don't expect you to know what this bill does. We don't yet know. We've not really looked at it properly, but I'm assuming you would agree that in general terms, we need to pass a law that changes the police complaints process. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's absolutely necessary.
Definitely.
And that's why you're here.
That's a major factor.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay.
This would have saved a number of months of distress and suffering in my case. It was clear that PERT had to go to the pace of Police Scotland, and Police Scotland were going at their own pace. So this is a vital option. This is one of the most important suggestions, in my opinion.
Thank you.
Okay. John Swinney.
Thanks very much, Kabir. And good morning, Stephanie. Thank you very much for coming in today and for the courage you've demonstrated in facing up to these circumstances, which we're truly sorry about. One of the points you just made to Russell Finlay a moment ago was you said that you were essentially having to work against the system, and you were pleading for help from the police. Now, that strikes me as being entirely the wrong place for you to be as a mother who was searching for your son. I'm worried about that. So I wonder if you could just say to us a little bit more about how you felt about how the police were acting towards you when you began to raise your concerns about how they had handled your case?
I just had a wee baby, and the way they came into my house, sorry, but they would wear bulletproof vests. And I was only a wee mammy, and I've never been involved with the police in my entire life. And my boy, everybody says a boy's good, you know, but my boy wasn't involved with any trouble. He had a job right up, and they scared me. They really scared me into asking, are you looking for my son? Are you dead? And when my partner was saying some things, I was saying, oh, I'm going to not say that, because what if they don't look for Reese? So you're scared to kind of speak up, because I felt sick right at the wee baby, so I was, they came out and the radio was going through, and his wife saying, what do you want for dinner? Something like that, I heard. So I stood up and I had to go to the toilet, and they went, sit down. I went, I can't, please, can I? And they were telling me to sit down, so I sat down with the baby and I was holding my baby, and I felt scared in my own house, intimidated. Just awful. My wee boy's out there, 19, and I'll tell you what, one day they came and says, sorry, we can't go and look for these today. And for 2 days, I said, oh, please, it's a lovely day. And they went, look, there's a football thing's happening, and we need all the police officers to go to this place. So I said, what came out and told me? And they couldn't go and look for my baby for 2 days. And the short space he was missing. It was hard.
So, situation. Thank you for sharing that with us. What the point you make there highlights to me that in that short period of time between Rhys going missing and his body being discovered, that the police made mistakes. Is that a fair? And then from that, do you think your experience of the complaints process, which clearly you've made it very clear to us it was a terrible experience of the complaints process, do you think your experience was bad because the police could not face up to the fact that they had mishandled the initial investigation?
That's what 1,000%, that's what I think, yes. Okay. Yes, I think 1,000%,
So what would your message be to us about what it is we've got to fix here? Because it sounds like what you're saying to us is that, and, you know, we're all human. We make mistakes. So the police will make mistakes. We all make mistakes.
I understand things like that, but mistakes like that can't be undone.
I've been a politician for years. I made mistakes. I got some things wrong. But what's important is about just being open.
Definitely. To come and say, be open to things at the start and say, right, we've done this wrong at the very start. We are so sorry. We're going to rectify this right now at the very start. When we found out like things or whatever, but they knew from the start it was wrong, I believe.
So that was not your experience of what happened here? That the police did not say to you, look, we've got this wrong?
Never. Right. Still no apologise. They said they won't apologise to my representative, because it's been over the time scale of the complaints, so they won't give me an apology. I've already said that to my representative. I got that from Park. I thought that, seeing I read that, I was, oh God, my insides all turned, and I didn't even apologise. It's horrible.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Kavir.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, just, I know this is extremely hard for you, Stephanie, so just take your time and we can easily suspend the meeting for a couple of moments if we need to, so that's absolutely fine. Can I maybe just come in and pick up from the point that John Swinney's just covered? And I wonder if I can ask you a wee bit about what you think Police Scotland maybe needs to be thinking about changing in terms of the way they respond, but particularly to incidents whereby someone dies in unexplained circumstances, as was the case with your son tragically. So what do they need to be thinking about in terms of how they can improve the way that they respond to that?
Every unexplained death shouldn't be put down when your loved one's missing like that. It should just be put down as suspicious straight away.
Right.
Not.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, sorry if it's something. I think it should be down as suspicious. Is that the right question you asked me there? I
know that makes sense. Thank you for that.
Instead of on us.
And I wonder, just on that then, that's a helpful response.
Yes.
And one of the things in my mind on that is perhaps the role of some sort of family liaison support or a family liaison officer. Do you have any views on that, the benefit of that? Or is that something that you were offered?
No, I was never offered that. No, and I think that would make a big, big difference.
Okay.
Because I had to sit in and wait, and my son was missing for the 15 days, and I got a phone call every second day at 10 o'clock at night. Mm. And that was only my contact with Police Scotland, and that was my wee phone calls at that time, and with nothing. And it was awful.
Okay, thank you. I'm just looking around the room to see if there are any other questions that any members want to ask. And if not, I wonder if I can maybe just draw the session to a close, Stephanie, and just ask if there's anything else that we haven't covered this morning about the bill or the police complaint system.
The database.
That you think it's important that the committee should know about.
Uh-huh.
Any final thoughts?
I think about the database. I absolutely agree that PERC should be given access to Police Scotland's complaint database. This would have made a great difference for the better in my case.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see this causing any negative issues for the public or the complainer. I suspect that the police might be more guarded with what they put on the database if they know PERC can access it. But I think this is really important recommendation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. So I'm going to bring this session to a close. Thank you so much, Stephanie, for joining us this morning. I think what you've shared with us has been extremely valuable for the committee to hear.
Thank you.
And thank you to your support in the public gallery. That's most appreciated.
Thank you.
So we'll just have a short suspension and that will allow us to have a changeover of witnesses. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, members. So we'll now move on, and I would like to welcome Mr. Bill Johnson to the meeting. Good morning, Bill. So thank you for taking the time to attend today's meeting. We're very grateful for you doing so. It's very much appreciated. And thank you for kindly providing background information about your experience. So I intend to allow around 45 minutes for this session, but before we get underway, I'm just going to turn to Russell Finlay. I believe you'd like to declare an interest.
Yes, it's just to declare a more full interest than I initially did, in that I've known Bill Johnson for many years, and I've written a book about his case, which is titled Fitted Up, and I think it's probably proper that I let others ask the majority of questions and I may come in, but thank you.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So I thought, if I may, I'll just open up with a fairly general question, if I may, about the police complaint system. So I wonder what you think about, or what you think should be changed about the police complaint system as it stands at the moment, but based on your own experience.
First of all, thank you for allowing me to come up here to give my experience to the committee. And I'd like to say, the lady who's just left, I could recognise every single item that she mentioned in her statement. Yeah. Everything that she stated is exactly, and worse, than what she stated. Yeah. To answer your question, I would date in two parts. The first part is dead straight, and that is, I would change everything. Mm-hmm. The reason for that is because, in my long experience in the military, I've seen this in-house investigation carry on going on for many years with the police in Northern Ireland and in the military. And it is, by definition, not fit for purpose. It is fatally flawed right from the outset. Because when politicians expect police officers to do the job that they do, right, which is really difficult, everybody accepts that, right? It's the same in the military. A bond becomes there, right, that civilians don't really maybe understand. You're an ex-police officer yourself, right? So, depending on the level of complaint, the system was designed 90% on trust and 5% on naivety. Because if you think that police officers, even in the most basic complaint, will sit down and decide that they're going to maybe ruin their pal's career. And I say their pal because the system is so flawed that even for a normal complaint, something that we would think was not that serious. In my case, I went along to a police station who was, the officers concerned, it was dead serious at the time, there was a fire, there was virtually no investigation, right? My initial complaint about the CID officers who were there at the spot is that they'd basically done nothing. So I was invited to go down to the same police station that these officers were dispatched from, to speak to their DI, right? So I was dealing with almost entirely with the CID, right? They knew nothing of my background at the time, and I didn't mention that. To me, it wasn't relevant. So when I went down there, I was speaking to their detective inspector, right? The two detective constables involved. And he took a kind of brief statement. At that point, these things didn't exist. This was 2009. So I'm sitting there, and this the DI, Detective Inspector, takes a statement, right? He's their direct superior officer. So that makes him an interested party. Because the outcome of the complaint, and it was quite serious at that point, the outcome of the complaint would most definitely affect him as their line officer. Because it goes down to his management and everything else, right? So if he's going to be saying, yeah, that was ridiculous, they didn't investigate that, they didn't bother about the foot of the fire, they didn't interview any of the witnesses whose names you gave, right? You recognise all this as an ex-police officer. When they've done nothing and he's sitting there, he can do two things. He can be absolutely candid, like the lady was saying, there was none of that, right? And there wasn't any. And he could say, right, OK, we'll deal with these two guys, there'll be whatever's going to be happening. And within that process, but it's not a criminal allegation you're making, right? In the event, he sent me a letter that was just absolute nonsense, right? And saying you can go to professional standards. Now, the problem with professional standards is professional standards is manned by the same guys that they used to be pals with when they were serving cops, or they're still cops. Now, I've seen all this nonsense with the RUC Northern Ireland in the day and with the army, and that's because the in-house investigation thing I couldn't believe was still going on in Scotland. But when the letter came and I went to professional standards, they only go by what they get from the police. You don't see what they get, ever. So you go to professional standards. I've done it through my solicitor. But what made my case so serious in the beginning was rather than going to professional standards alone, the chief of the CID at that time was a lady called Anne Maguire. She was the senior officer in charge of the CID in Scotland. So I went directly to Anne Maguire. And then the whole system went completely against me. But the lady was saying there, she must have complained, was made and it became serious.
Okay.
The complainer became the victim of Police Scotland.
Yeah. So can I just kind of draw you back to the question about you? So what you've spoke about earlier on and you've kind of teased out in your response is around that sort of bond, that camaraderie, perhaps culture within Police Scotland. So again, just thinking about the provisions in the bill and the bill being an opportunity to address some of these issues that you've described, in your view, what are the key things that Police Scotland need to think about in terms of how that bond and the implications of it, if you like, can be addressed?
You've heard it right in the head, convener, right? You can't remove that bond from police officers,
okay,
or firemen or soldiers or anybody else who work in that type of environment. Mm-hmm. It's naive to think that you can say to them, look, you can't do this. What you need to do is you need to be... It just isn't happening, right? So you've got to remove... This might sound quite harsh, but the only way to sort this, to have any chance that you're going to have a complaint system where you don't end up like that lady there. I mean, I was 10 years in this system. 11 years, actually, right? In the public interest in Scotland, for all the people in Scotland, you have got to remove the police from the system in the first stages of the complaint. Because the environment is, right, the first initial officer who's dealing with it, right, and you've got a culture there where you've... I mean, a self-investigation is a situation where it can only breed corruption.
Yeah.
That's an environment where it's going to thrive, mm-hmm, right? So there is no way that you can change the system where you're going to make police officers decide, you know what, mm-hmm, I'm just going to ruin you, right? You might even be going to the jail. And guess what? See, because I covered up to begin with, maybe I'm coming with you. That is not going to happen. So there's nothing you can do to change that system except remove the police from the initial stages entirely.
Yeah.
And somebody else must deal with it. And you've got to wheel round that.
Yeah. OK, thank you. You spoke about, you said just a moment ago that this was 10 years of your life.
Yeah.
So it's obviously one of the issues that we're very... aware of is the extraordinarily long timescales that some people, mm-hmm, experience. Do you think, in terms of the bills, again, coming back to what the bill contains, do you think that it does enough to address the issue of lengthy timescales that people are experiencing, and how do you think that should be changed?
The way to change it is see it in the initial complaint. I'll use the example of PERC, for instance, right? When you first go to PERC, there's a short time period when they've got to respond to you, right? It's like something like 30 days. So PERC will come back to you and they'll say, right, we've got your complaint, right, and this is your response. Mm-hmm. We are waiting for the documents from the police. Mm-hmm. Now, therein lies the problem. Because depending on what documents and evidence, documentary evidence or whatever that the police cherry-pick that they're going to send to PERC, mm-hmm. and depending on how long they want to play out before it gets to PERC, leaves it open-ended. Here's the first example with PERC. When I first went to PERC, it was 2 years before I made my complaint that involved PERC before they came back to me. And when I seen the heads of complaint, the heads of complaint were absolutely ridiculous compared to what the complaint was. For instance, I was allocated a false criminal record, and it was done by way of alias. Right, now, I don't know if you know what that means, right? I've actually got a copy of the record here, but that's... You'll know this better than anybody. The criminal history system, you've got the CID, you've got the CHS, which is the actual system, and you've got the general criminal history system that is in one big sphere, right? To allocate somebody a criminal record by way of alias, it's a conscious act. There is but one way it can be done. You've got to go into the system, you've got to find somebody who is more or less close enough to whoever it is that you're looking at, similar date of birth, close enough in age, height and everything else, right? And you've got to make an entry within the CHS, a marker, that links that person to that criminal history, to that SCRO, right? The Scottish Criminal History System. I can see that you recognise that, convener, what I'm saying there, right? Now, to do that, the only way that is possible is for somebody to sit down. A police officer can only do this, not a civilian, not a member of staff, right? They've got to sit down and they've got to consciously go in there and they've got to link you by marker and maybe a small bit of intelligence as an alias used by this criminal. So when I was speaking to police officers about the 28 crimes that was reported, the crimes were death threats, fire raising, vehicles being set on fire, vehicles being destroyed. 28 crimes, not a single detection in any of these crimes. 4 instances of CCTV footage never recovered. So that record, when I found out about that and actually got a copy of the record when I was charged by the police, I realised that's why the police's focus during this whole 3 years was on me and not the perpetrator of these crimes. Because the criminal record, as my counsel put it, was amongst one of the worst criminal records they'd ever came across.
So I think what you're saying from that is that these actions, if you like, contributed to the lengthy timescales that you experienced.
Well, PERC and the police, right? I personally see PERC as another line of defence for the police, and I'll give you a very, very good instance shortly, right? PERC are an organisation where, in theory, right, they can hold the police to account. The police are in control of all the documents and all the timescale. At that point, PERC is open-ended. If you made a timescale where they say that they've got to conclude, say, within 6 months, mm-hmm. for talking sake, right? And the police were forced to produce the documents within that period, that would not mean that the police wouldn't be cherry-picking what they sent to PERC, because the most important thing is the complainer is never allowed access mm-hmm. to what has been sent to PERC. Mm-hmm. And if you ask for it, no chance.
Mm-hmm. OK, thank you for that. I know that other members would like to come in, and we've got a little bit of a limited time, so I'm just going to open it up and ask if any other members would like to come in. Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Johnson. Thanks very much for coming in to talk to us. It's just going back to some of your, you know, you're talking about the park and some of your previous comments that I'm understanding now that you don't think park is, you know, independent enough to do the scrutiny on the police and that the complete system should be outside of that.
I'm going to give you a really good, strong example shortly that.
Just so you think somebody entirely independent board should be investigating complaints?
Yeah.
And also, was there any mention at any time of the Scottish Police Authority during the long time you've been involved?
No, I was dealing with fairly senior officers, detective, chief inspectors, people like that, right? And when my allegations changed from serious allegations about what they like to call a service complaint. Like, for instance, when I found out about the false record and says this is malice, and I was sitting down with a DCI in Helen Street, and at that point of the game, he knew that I understood the system very well. Mm. It hadn't changed. One of the units within the army that I worked with, we had full access to the criminal history system across the UK, right? So I understood the system inside, basically, right? He realised at that point that I understood how this criminal record could have came around, right? And it became completely impossible at that point for my complaint to go any further. He shut it down. Mm-hmm. The perk thing, right, is like just a ring of defence from the police. Mm-hmm. You're obviously interested in this perk situation, right? I'm going to give you an example here which covers that completely. Now, this here is a copy of the police complaint system, right? That's the process. Now, one of the most important parts of this, I'll just read this line, it's just one line, right, to you, right? It's, if the allegation lodged is of a criminal nature, the force cannot resolve, and this is the important bit, or attempt to resolve the complaint. Right? Now, that's in the complaints process. Unfortunately, it's usurped by the police's operational procedures. This is what you've got to look at. Mm. Because there's a paragraph in there that says, if the allegation is a criminal allegation, the contradiction to that statement, which is in here, is in there, but the paragraph says, if the complaint is criminal in nature, an inspector can report to the Crown, which is what they're saying, or it can report to professional standards. So as professional standards can assess the allegation. Now, I'm not finished, right? So in my case, this letter here was sent to Chief Constable Livingston, who's just retired. On that letter there, which I sat down with counsel and done, there was 18 police officers on this list. The highest ranking officer was a detective chief inspector. 9 of the complaints were for perverting the course of justice, preventing evidence being available, right? Now, everybody knows that's a crime. That's a common law crime, right? Correct? Now, that gets sent to the Chief Constable. The Chief Constable goes straight back to the DCI, who's the top of the list on this complaint, for him to deal with the complaint. So what he does is he gets an SI, a superintendent, to send me this letter. And in this letter here, she says, we have sent your complaint to professional standards, right? blah, 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 and they have confirmed that the allegations you have raised do not amount to criminality. And unless you are prepared to accept your complaint being non-criminal in nature, we will abandon your complaint. Now, before I'd done this here, I'd spent 3 years building this case against these police officers. Why? Because we had had the disclosure during the trial that I was on with the police and acquitted unanimously. Now, she says to me, but you can go to Perk. So I went to Perk. And Perk came back and Perk said, bear with me a wee second here. After 10 months, Perk came back and said, just give me a wee second here, because I definitely have it here, I brought it with me. It is. I'll tell you what it was because I've no brought this with me. Perk came back and said, we can't deal with your complaint, Mr. Johnston, because the allegations are criminal in nature. Just take that in for a minute. Right? Now, when Perk do that, what they're supposed to do in the SOPs, Perk had the authority to deal with that. Right? To deal with it, they've got to send it to the Crown or they've got to go back to the police and say, we've responded to this complaint and you will deal with us as criminal. Now, at that point, the letter for Perk, the lady says to me, I've had to go to my senior review officer. She had to go to a senior review officer to decide if perverting the course of justice was a criminal allegation. Now, I would imagine it would take 10 minutes for somebody to figure that one out, right? That's a criminal allegation, right? Not 10 months. Mm-hmm. The 10 months was taken in with me continuously emailing and phoning this review officer and getting panned off all the way down the line.
So you think they were hoping that you would just give up and say, I'm not waiting any longer, or, you know...
This became so serious, right, yeah, that when I was asked to go and speak to Dame Elise Angelini about this case, right, Dame Elise was shocked, and she won't mind me saying this, she was shocked that I had not been put in front of the fiscal years before. She looked at the paperwork which I showed her and she looked across to the other lawyers that was there and her actual words were, while we are doing this. Because the officers involved in this, where it started off as it being covered up and then becoming criminal. Back to what the convener was asking about the loyalty of officers, right? When this became criminal, what you were talking about here was just about half of the CID officers in Glasgow. When I was in trial, there was 28 police officers. Russell was there in the court, right? There was 28 police officers, CID officers, bar one uniformed officer was called by my counsel. Mm-hmm. And the police officers who had charged me were actual four of the officers who were subject to the complaint before I was charged. Mm-hmm. That night that I got attacked with a guy with a knife after the death threats, right? I phoned the police. The police came, they put me in the back of the van, right? I'm looking out the window and I see two of the CID officers who've been dealing with who were part of my complaint, a detective sergeant and a detective inspector from Maryhill, talking to the uniformed officers.
I know it's very difficult not to refer to your own experience, but I wonder if I can maybe just move you on, because there's quite a number of questions that we would like to ask. And obviously,
because in this case, it may probably take 2 years to go over.
I'm sure it would. Are you finished? Okay, thank you. So in that case, I'll bring in John Swinney.
Thanks. Mr. Johnson, you raise an important issue about which actually Stephanie Bonner also raised with us in the earlier evidence session, that essentially that there is a necessity or it appears as a necessity for the initial investigation of complaints about police conduct to be handled by a body outside of Police Scotland. Yep. Is that your reflection on your experience?
I think you've got to have something like an ombudsman type thing, right? Who are out with the whole criminal justice system.
Do you think does PIRC meet your expectations?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. Okay.
In the two occasions that I went to PIRC, right, there were very, very serious allegations. One of them was a criminal one, but PIRC obviously agreed that the police, you know, for these officers to put their neck in the line in writing to say these allegations are not criminal allegations, right? No, false statements on crime reports. This kind of carry on. This is all serious, serious stuff, right, for these police officers. Plus, all the documentary evidence that my lawyers and I had got during disclosure, during the trial, right? So, PIRC, in my view, and it's not just my view, I read through your bill, right? And I noticed in your bill, especially the section 13 of the bill, I think it was, right? The consultations, everybody seemed to be questioning the independence of PIRC, which I'm not surprised at, right? So you would need to have people who, A, were never police officers, they're not the Crown, they're not professional standards. So this is what you get paid for, right? To figure out how you're going to do this. And I don't envy it, because when you've got a community, especially in Scotland, it's a small country, it's a community police force. I mean, it's a large police force. Huge. But you can't have them dealing with their own complaints. You can't have them in any part of the process. So to answer your question, you would have to have a completely independent, and this is where you've got a problem, a totally independent body to look at the complaints, regardless of how serious they are. They decide if it's criminal. They decide if it's what the head of complaint is. For instance, when I made the criminal allegation about the false criminal record, the head of complaint was, we see this as a service complaint. Now, that is a bad service. But it's also a joke. It's a criminal allegation. It's not a service complaint. And that, PIRC took that as a service complaint and dealt with as a service complaint in the first visit to PIRC.
And is that, do you think that's just in the nature, like you've made a very strong argument there, that all these issues need to be taken way out of the hands of anybody who's had anything to do with the issues previously, which is actually, in a logical sense, the type of practice you would have in all processes. You can't, for example, have somebody on a panel making a decision if they've been involved in the case beforehand.
So I was sitting giving statements, lengthy statements, to a detective inspector in Helen Street, right? One of the statements was against a detective chief inspector. And when I was at number 5 police officer, I'm leaving there, and next door to the DI who's taking the statements of criminality. This is no trivial stuff. This is serious, serious issues here. Police officers possibly going to prison. The DCI, his boss is sitting next door in the office next door, basically, right? That's when I says to him, you told me you're an independent. You've got nothing to do with this. I says to him, who's your superior officer? I says, is it him? I pointed to the name on the door, next door, who's on this list. And he went, well, yes, but that doesn't really matter. And I went like, right. Okay. This stops. So I'm sitting there with a DI who's subordinate to the top guy on this list, who the chief constable has sent to him to deal with the complaint against the criminal allegations against these guys. Okay. Now, that's just bonkers. So you can't have the police taking part in the complaint system. then for as long as you want to leave them in there, you'll be doing this all over again, with ladies like that lady, 4 or 5 years down the line.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you.
I wondered if I can just ask about the duty of candour. So the bill contains a proposal around creating a duty of candour for Police Scotland. So so officers and staff are required to be truthful, candid and cooperate in proceedings. Do you think that this is, from your experience, is this sufficient for you to have more confidence that police officers would cooperate with investigations, for example, so including those against other officers? And if not, what do you think should be put in place in that regard, around a duty of candour?
The only way you're going to get complete candour for police officers against other police officers is if they're under oath, and before they're under oath, they're presented with evidence to show that if you go in there and you just spin a story for your pals, that you are going to be going to jail. That's the only way you can do it. Because if you're wanting candour for any organisation, right, in particular the police, and as I said earlier, I've seen this in the military, to its detriment, we done in-house investigations as well at regimental level. I mean, it was ridiculous. You had colonels holding courts of inquiry, boards of inquiry, about serious, serious issues, when it really should have been dealt with completely away from the military altogether. Mm-hmm. But the problem you've got here is, you can take it away from the military and maybe even give it to the police. Mm-hmm. Then you're going to get some sort of an independent investigation. Mm-hmm. But with Police Scotland, any other police force, when you have it, it's solely been dealt with by police officers, then it's by definition just raw right from the start. It's not going to work.
Okay. And I suppose linked to that, again within the bill, there is a provision which places a legal obligation on Police Scotland to create a code of ethics. Would that give you more confidence in the behaviour of the police? And also, should there be some sort of sanction or implication should an officer breach the code of ethics?
Absolutely, but the problem you've got is, how do you decide when he's breached the code of ethics when there's nobody going to cooperate? And then when you're sending all your paperwork to Park, when you've actually cherry-picked it and how long you take it, it just doesn't work. As I say right from the start, the only way you can sort this is root and branch. And that involves having an organisation that is completely divorced from the police force altogether. Mm-hmm. So the ethics thing and all that is all very well, but nobody's going to be going along with that. That should be there just now. These are police officers that we're talking about. These are guys that are supposed to be out there protecting people in Scotland. Right? Mm-hmm. So she's saying, do you think if they had better ethics, it would be all right? The answer's no, because it's not going to happen.
Okay, thank you. Fulton McGregor, I think you want to come in, and then I'll bring in something.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Thanks, Bill, for your, again, very powerful testimony and coming in here and trying to make change with this. I think you've made it pretty clear to colleagues already that you don't think the PIRC, you know, is really the right body to deal with this, but obviously the bill has got some focus on improving, if you like, for want of a better word, PIRC's role and making it more robust. And we have heard, although we've just started, we have heard some evidence already that instances where PIRC has been successful, maybe, or is the right word, or has been effective. Effective is probably the right word. That's clearly not been the case in your case, in your instance. So if there wasn't to be what your wish is for a totally new, brand new, independent organisation, and it is to the main function is to remain with PIRC. Is there anything you think that can be put through this bill to improve PIRC even further, to provide that distance between, you know, the police officers and PIRC?
I think, especially in fairly serious complaints, The complainant should be given a statement direct to the PERT. If you were going to keep PERT in place, I'm talking about here, which I don't think is maybe a good idea, but if you were going to do that, then there will be complaints that are fairly trivial and everything else, right? That are not going to be a massive concern, although for the people it's a big concern. But the PERT can only be effective if they've got teeth, and I mean real teeth, right? If they can enforce the release of documentation from the police, but mainly if the initial statement is given to PERC or an organisation that is like PERC, right? And the police are not allowed to be in that initial stage, because the initial stage, depending on the officer, depending on the seriousness of the complaint, it will be predetermined where this is going to go. You get in a police station, you start talking about criminal allegations and all the rest of it, right? It will be predetermined in that police station about where that's going, or in my case, where it get blocked. In my case, I even... Dame Elise gave me the second name and details of the fiscal who dealt with complaints against the police, criminal allegations, right? So I sent, through my solicitor, right, two separate points of contact, I sent an email to the fiscal, to this fiscal, who Dame Elise gave me the details, and it was sent by the post, and it was sent via my solicitor. And that was in 2020, just before COVID, right? And we have heard nothing. Nothing. Now, we don't know how bad COVID was, I know, because I had it twice. But I can assure you, that went to the fiscal, and the fiscals went to the DCI, or the SI, by that stage, there's a superintendent on this, and the fiscal spoke to them, and they've said, ah, that's just, this guy's just nuts. Now, a question that the committee might think of, is I was doing this for 11 years, for 7 years, it was serious criminal allegations against senior CID officers. 18 of them. Who we could see, counsel, not just me, could see had broke the law within the crime reports that we were given, right? And the evidence there was very, very, very strong. So why have I not been charged? We're making these vexatious complaints against police officers, or wasting police time for the last 10 years, almost 12 years, in fact, if you go back to the non-criminal stuff. Now, I would suggest if anybody in this room walked into the nearest police station today and made a complaint of any of this nature against a CID officer, particularly a senior officer, say a detective chief inspector or a superintendent, right? If that complaint you made was vexatious, if it was false, if it was just you were just doing it because you wanted to, you would be very quickly charged and you'd be put in front of a judge. This hasn't yet went in front of a judge. The police have never charged me with anything to do with that, right? Yeah, they ran out and charged me when I was standing there after this guy tried to stab me. Didn't bother taking any DNA samples off the knife, which I told them to make sure they'd done off the handle. But they should think, why have I never been charged? A book was written with this whole story in it. They were all named, every single individual police officer, MSPs are all named in this book. And nobody, absolutely nobody, has come back and says, what's that all about? You're a DCI and you're in a book for corruption. Accused of corruption and you don't do nothing.
Can I bring you back in full, Tim McGregor? I'm just conscious of time and I've got a couple more questions.
Bill was answering my questions. I just maybe go back to what I was asking. So I think just to clarify, you're saying that if, you know, obviously the PERC isn't your preference, but PERC is in place, but at that very early stage of the process, that the police officers who the complaints are against, they shouldn't have any involvement at all in that initial approach from PERC.
No.
Initial approach to PERC.
Well, PIRC had details of the complaint. It was criminal allegations that was deemed by professional standards and the police and a superintendent that were not criminal in nature, to use their words. Right? And PIRC took 10 months to come back and say to me, well, actually, we can't do nothing for you because they are. So PIRC are an organisation which I don't think are fit for purpose.
Well, and I should have said that there, in terms of not having any contact or any, the police officers concerned not having any, not being able to view those complaints, that should either be, that should be the case either through formal or informal processes, because it's informal. I think you sound most concerned about is that informal culture, which will be in any organisation, but particularly something as high profile and high risk as the police.
I mean, I had phone calls for one of the DIs that's on this list here, right? Quite in the kind of middle of the process, right? Seemed to me, yeah, I've spoke to PIRC, naming the person he was talking to at PIRC, right? And then I'm saying, well, hang on a minute here. This guy's subject to the complaint. This DI is subject to a serious complaint, and he's talking to Mrs. So-and-so, who it was it was dealing with. I'm not going to name anybody, right? Was just just shocking. I mean, like, the mere fact that there was correspondence with A2 on a phone, the woman in PIRC who was dealing with my complaint, and one of the people who was involved, subject to the complaint, a criminal allegation, was talking to this lady at PIRC. Mm-hmm. And he definitely was. There was no, he wasn't just saying that to try and bluff or try and play it down, 100%. Because when I asked her, she kind of ducked and dived a wee bit. But she did say, well, I mean, that is part of the process, and I haven't noticed, isn't it?
OK. Thanks.
OK. Russell Finlay.
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm struck by the fact the same tactics that you've experienced, you recognised in respect of what Stephanie Bonner went through. The fact that these have been replicated in respect of a grieving mother and a former British Army intelligence officer is quite something. Now, my question is, helpfully, I think, a yes or no question. It's one I've never asked you before. 9 years ago, you discovered you had been wrongly and potentially criminally assigned a criminal record by way of alias. Police Scotland have not told you at any point how that has happened. And yes or no, do you think that they will ever disclose that to you?
No.
Okay. And next question is, in terms of, a lot of our focus is on the police, but I think sometimes we can overlook the role of the Crown Office in much of policing work in Scotland. They very often work hand in glove. And in your case, just by virtue of speaking to Dame Eilish Angelini, you were directed towards making a direct complaint to the criminal allegations against the police division of Crown Office.
Yep.
You also referenced attempting to have your complaint heard by PIRC, but the concern was Police Scotland are in a position to cherry pick, was the phrase you used, what they disclose of your allegations.
Yep.
The same goes for what their disclosure might be to the Crown Office, although in this case they didn't choose to disclose. The question is, and it's to do with the legislation, would there perhaps be a mechanism whereby if there was full transparency around these submissions, both to PIRC and to the Crown from Police Scotland, that would go some way to building public confidence that at least you knew that the powers that be, PIRC and the Crown, were being told something that was reflective of what the complainer was saying.
I would actually add to that by saying that the funding, for instance, I had to fund everything myself today with lawyers and all sorts, right? To add to that, the complainant should have access to funding to get a suitable solicitor who should also have access to what is going to the Crown from the police, to PIRC for the police, etc. So as the actual complainant is always in the dark. Always. So whatever's getting disclosed, there should be a legal mechanism there where the complainant has got a lawyer that is paid for by the system, so as they get access to that.
I mean, one proposal in the bill is that PERC should have access to Police Scotland's systems, which seems perfectly sensible. It opens things up if there are attempts to withhold certain information, but that's opposed, I think, by the Federation. Now, there's one quick point. You described going to PERC, who said they couldn't look at a particular set of circumstances because they were of a criminal nature.
Yep.
But then when you went to Police Scotland with the same information, they said they deemed this not to be criminal. If you didn't accept that, they wouldn't look at it.
Correct.
It was an absolute catch-22.
It was also an illegal act by the officer involved because she blocked lawful process. When PERC say these are criminal allegations, when counsel say these are criminal allegations, and an unnamed sergeant at professional standards decides that they're not criminal allegations, right? False statements on crime reports, all sorts of things, really serious crimes for a police officer to commit, and numerous, and backed with evidence.
And you've got nowhere to turn at the end of the day.
You're just jammed, because what do? You do what I've done. You do what Dame Angelini suggested, and you go straight back to them again, because I went in there twice, don't forget. Right? And the same thing happens again, and that thing is nothing, because it's too big. There's too many police officers involved, and you're going to end up with half the CID in Helen Street in the back of your van.
I will have to come in and just draw things to a close. We're just running slightly over time. I know we could sit here probably for the rest of the morning, but on that, thank you very much for attending this morning. It has been very valuable to hear your views. So on that, we'll have a short suspension and a change of the witnesses. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Thank you again, members. So I would now like to welcome Magdalene Robertson to the meeting. Ms. Robertson is joining us online and I believe prefers to be addressed by the name Maggie. So welcome to the meeting this morning, Maggie, and thank you for taking the time to give evidence to us today. We do really appreciate it, and thank you for kindly providing some background information about your experience. So I intend to allow around about 45 minutes for this evidence session. And I wonder if I need to ask Mr. Finlay if you would like to declare an interest before we start?
Just in that I've previously spoken with Maggie in respect of what she's been attempting to deal with. So, yes.
Thank you very much indeed. So, Maggie, I'm going to open up just with a very general question about the police complaint system. So can I ask, what do you think should be changed about the police complaint system based on your own experience?
Okay. To be changed completely would be what I would suggest. To talk about all the things that don't work would be to talk about mainly everything, to scrap and reset and have something completely new based on different morals, based from a different group, would be the way forward. So I'd say scrap and set up again, and not with the minds of those who caused the issues and the problems in the first place. You cannot set up a new create a new way forward working with those minds that created the issues in the first place.
Okay, thanks for that. One of the issues that has come up in evidence sessions that we've had this morning has been that of timescales, which I think you will be able to relate to. I wonder if I can ask you a little bit about that and how any potential delays in the system impact on people involved in the system, and what should we be thinking about in terms of how that is addressed within the context of the bill that we're looking at?
Okay, so time delays, times should be set. Mm-hmm. There is unknowns and there's knowns. For the unknowns, we cannot set a time. Nobody can, mm-hmm. because they don't know about it yet. But what they should be able to do is have a plan in place about what their expectations are and deliver on those. For the unknowns that they do not know, that they haven't dug up. This is an investigation. So the plan should be set in place about what their expectations are and what they intend to achieve. And report and summary should be given back to the complainer and internally to their auditors or their group about how they're managing to progress. Also, things may have a turnabout where it becomes much more serious. For example, somebody could be charged with murder in between that investigation. That changes, doesn't it? It becomes much more serious. So the pace then needs to change and they need to evolve that process to suit. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that. That's really helpful. I'm going to open up questions to other members. I may come back in with one or two, but I'm going to bring in Katie Clark, first of all.
Thank you, and thank you very much, Maggie, for being willing to speak to the committee today. And what you're suggesting is that we start again with a complaints process. Now, PARC, what we have at the moment, has only actually been in place a relatively short period of time, just a few years. And you've talked about morals, that you'd want an organisation that had a different set of morals. So how would you ensure that any new system doesn't fall into any traps or failings that PARC has? And do you not think PARC perhaps could be reformed to incorporate some of the changes that you are suggesting?
No, I'll stick with the fact is you cannot fix a problem with the same minds that created the problem. That's well established. That's a basic rule for life and living. Now, what we have got here is organisational culture within the police department, where you do not get ahead unless you fit in with that culture. If you think out with that, you're not going to get ahead. Now, PARC is set up of ex-police. That's the same culture. That's in mindset. We cannot go ahead with making improvements and investigating police from the same mindset that's created these issues. You can't do it. It's impossible. I don't know why this was set up in such a way in the first instance.
So if I could just sort of pick that up, because we heard something similar from a previous witness. If you're saying that former police officers aren't the appropriate people to be employed in those roles, what kind of skill set do you think that the organisation should draw from?
I think we should be looking at the debate based around about why these were hired in the first place. Now, the organisation, the people from that and the culture and the mindset that they develop and learn, because regardless whether you're against that culture or not against that culture, when you join an organisation, you have to develop and get along in that culture. You adopt that. You always do. You have to. It's basic psychology. Okay, so when you move to the other side, park, and you get hired, there's the old boy network, there's the group, there's a police gang, there's, oh, do you remember this? And there's this group and this set in place. So for setting up a new department, you need to set that up within yourselves and figure out how you are going to do it. But the current way is not the way. We see that. It's corrupt. Holy, holy corrupt.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Katie.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay now.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, Maggie. Thanks for doing this. It's just following really on from Katie's questions about the perk. I mean, I'm looking at the response you got from them after your complaint was made. And they say that senior police officers or an officer gave instruction to detectives involved in a murder investigation to ignore your rape allegation against a named individual. And after you provided the additional statement in 2015, there's been an activity and this male has not been questioned by detectives subsequent to you providing this statement. And they say that their role was to examine the manner in which your complaints were handled by the police. And they indicate that although the review would consider how the police investigated the complaints, they would not be investigating your complaints or the matters giving rise to them. And they didn't uphold your complaint about the police. That seems astonishing to me, because yeah, you know, it's almost funny. It's just so strange. How did you feel when you got that response?
I knew I was going on to the hamster wheel. Mm-hmm. I knew that, and it was going to be a hamster wheel for years. I was going to get left with nothing. It was just going to be expelling energy. Mm-hmm. The only way that I could actually go through that was to do two things. Document it. Mm-hmm. Secondly, deal with my own mental health mm-hmm. during the process.
Yeah.
So that's what I'd done. Mm-hmm. That's what I'd done. I knew it was going to be difficult, but I knew that I had to look after myself at the same time. Mm-hmm. So when dealing with these, I mean, not only was it astonishing, but the fact is they lied consistently throughout the full entire process. Yeah. They had talked about interviewing the Ian Packer. They had talked about interviewing him in 2010, and they didn't. They really, really did not do that. So they lied, and then they wouldn't actually prove it. When I said, can you actually prove and verify that this was actually done, they wouldn't do it. So that was tough, because you know you're dealing with a liar, you know you're going to get your butt in your head and you can't get anywhere forward.
So did you feel you were being failed by the system at that point? And
I was being depleted of energy. Mm-hmm. I was being depleted. It was a exercise to deplete me of my energy so that I had nowhere else to go, and also deplete me of the time that I had, because everything's time barred, isn't it? So if I wanted to take the police to court for this, I had to go through this process that takes away that time bars in place, and that's ticking away. Mm-hmm. So that's the intention of PERC for me. I don't see it as anything else.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Rona. Thank you.
Thank you. Maggie, I wonder if I can just come in and ask you about the proposals around the duty of candour for Police Scotland. So can I ask if you think that the creation of a duty of candour for both officers and staff. So, you know, obviously, it relates to them being truthful, candid, and cooperating proceedings. Do you think that what is being proposed is sufficient for you to have confidence in that police officers will cooperate with investigations, including those that are carried out against or in relation to other officers?
Haven't they already sworn a duty and an oath? Already? Mm-hmm. And haven't they already got a duty under statutory law? Isn't that already bound in law? Hasn't that been bound in law for hundreds of years? Thousands of years, maybe even? How long have we had the police department? Mm-hmm. Why do we need another set of rules? So if I was in the police or in PIRC and someone says, do you like to create something in candour, create another set of duties? Yeah, I'll take that one. I'll write you as many lists as you want. It doesn't matter. It makes no difference. Absolutely scrap it. Keep to what we have. It's there. As soon as we start getting more specific on a general piece of law, then we're honing in and honing into very specific items. And when you don't know what happens when you get very, very specific, people find it easy to opt out. We didn't agree to that very specific item, but I still fit within the boundaries. Scrap it. It's a waste of time, and it's an absolute rabbit hole to get guided in by those in PIRC who are going to waste their time, money as well, dealing with this. No. Mm-hmm. Scrap it.
Okay, thank you for that. And just, I suppose, linked to that is another provision in the bill around ethics and a code of ethics. So do you feel that the provisions in the bill, which would place a legal obligation on Police Scotland to create a specific code of ethics, would that give you more confidence in the behaviour of officers? And just following on from that, should there be specific sanctions for a breach of the code of ethics?
I would look towards a breach for the codes of ethics that they've already had sworn to. I wouldn't create anything else. It absolutely doesn't. I can't express how much I disagree with that. But what I would just say is definitely should have clear criminal, minimum criminal terms or what the fines, anything there, what's the minimum they would suffer had if they don't, and it needs to be carried out. Mm-hmm. That's what needs to happen. They need to be charged. Mm-hmm. If they commit offences or they don't uphold their duties.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that. Any other members want to come in at all? Russell Finlay? Yeah,
please. Hi, Maggie.
Hi, Russell.
thank you for joining us. You described your ordeal or the police complaints process as being like a hamster wheel. A previous witness used the phrase a hellish merry-go-round, and I suppose what they've got in common is an endless circularity to them, and it seems to be designed that way. One thing that has been another common feature is the way in which, at the outset, the police are able to be very selective about how they categorise complaints, and that sets the tone and for everything going forward, both in terms of how they categorise it internally, how they might represent that to PIRC or indeed the Crown. Do you think much greater transparency around that particular crucial early moment could be a helpful thing for the bill to include if it doesn't already? And I'm not entirely sure if it does, to be honest.
Yeah, transparency is key, Russell. Transparency all the way through. It gives the person who's reporting the crime confidence. Crime, it might not be in crime, but reporting the incident anyway. How they categorise it, I think they need to maybe categorise it anyway to see how serious it is, to see who's going to deal with it. So maybe there does need to be some sort of categorisation, but there should be transparency, and the person making the complaint should have equal input into that. So it must be a meeting of the minds and an agreement.
So an absolute protocol whereby the complainer has to be fully appraised of what their complaint constitutes, and
yes.
No sort of slightly softening of things or removal of issues here. Now, some people who've not experienced what you, Stephanie, Bill and other witnesses have experienced might find all this quite extraordinary. You know, Police Scotland are very, very effective at telling the public that all is largely well, and it is absolutely the case. The vast majority of police officers do an incredibly difficult job and do so with the greatest of integrity. And I think the question is, can you perhaps explain why you think Police Scotland or any police force or big organisation might seek to waste people's time, waste public money on a process when in fact doing the right thing would be more efficient and better for the reputation in the long term?
When you have a culture and an organisation such as the police that's been going on all these hundreds of years, that's got this culture built up, people want to protect it. It's natural. They want to protect it. They don't want blame. So, that's why they will cover up. That's what I believe anyway.
So part of it's protecting the reputation of the organisation. And I suppose mm-hmm. also there's an element, as we've heard from Bill Johnson, about individual protection.
Mm-hmm.
And do you think this can be... I mean, so Bill Johnson and other witnesses have said that at the outset, every complaint should be looked at by some independent entity. There's huge cost implications to that. We've already heard concerns about this bill, the cost of this bill perhaps being much greater than the financial memorandum states. Would you agree that there needs to be every complaint would need to go through an independent body at the outset, even some kind of sifting process?
Then that would say that you should eliminate PERC, because if you need to have someone man-marking each step, that's an external body man-marking every step, then why don't they just do it? Why do we need PERC? Why don't we have a separate entity?
So the bill does allow PERC gives PERC much greater powers, so that might be the solution to... Yeah,
maybe have people that are not in the police or have not came from the police. We need to look at these networks that the police are involved in as well. These are old boy networks. These are people that have worked with each other, their families worked with each other, they're connected, they're in the same golf course, they could be in the same Masonic lodge, they could just know each other from media connections, football teams. They're involved in different ways. They're also, as well, connected personally within the workforce and how they manage these jobs. Now, if they've got something wrong and they've covered something up once, right at the beginning of their career, then people know about it. Then they cover up something else. Then something gets hidden. Something's not reported. Then it paints a picture. There's a bigger picture. There's a Pandora's box there to be opened, and none of them want that to be opened. These are not single little items that they don't want to have disclosed. These are big, major items. So, for example, when I asked for a freedom of information on the two PERC officers that were investigating my complaint and their relationship with the senior police officers that I reported that, they came back and they gave five pieces of legislation as to why they cannot provide this freedom of information to me. And they were absolutely ridiculous pieces of legislation. I mean, I've got them written down here. I'll tell you the name. Section 20, relationships with the UK. So they wouldn't provide me evidence, information on these police and their relationship with the senior police office because it would affect relationships with the UK, Northern Ireland, Wales. That's ridiculous. One also was Section 41, right? That one, if you know it, is exempt because it's related to communications with Her Majesty and the Royal Household. These are ridiculous pieces of legislation that they've gave back to me as an excuse for not sharing the freedom of information. So what I would like is clear freedom of information given before the police officers actually even do before PERC even do the investigation. What they should do is they should provide a statement of fact that they do or they do not know the officers that we're complaining about.
You're in the right place for freedom of information. Katie Clark's here. She's proposing a bill to improve and strengthen freedom of information. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Russell.
Thank you.
Thank you. Maggie, can I come in just with another question? And it's around misconduct procedures, but in the context of former police officers. So do you agree that misconduct procedures should be able to commence and continue against former police officers for allegations that, if they were proved, would amount to gross misconduct? I mean, should this only be in terms of gross misconduct? I'm interested in your views on that.
OK. I've got an example here. OK. So in my complaint, I wanted the perk to follow up against police officers. Now, there was one piece of information that I gave them many times, but they absolutely refused to check up on it. Now, this is really important because this was from Alexis Blake from the Crown. We know how senior Alexis Blake is from the Crown. Wrote to me and told me that she was investigating possible criminal activity of the senior police that I was complaining about. The PIRC decided that they would not follow up on that. That, for me, is key, and I think it's criminal that they did not follow up on that, and I still don't know what happened, but I don't even know where that report is from the Crown. That should be investigated as part of my complaint. So, yes, just if it's gross misconduct, we need to define what gross misconduct is. Niggle complaints about the police. Maybe it's a miscommunication, something small, but when something with this hard fact-based evidence that you have to hand, and it's not even from yourself, you're not even making that up, it's coming from the Crown, senior legal officials that represent Scotland are coming and saying we're investigating this. And if they're investigating possible criminal activity, do you know what? They must have had reasonable cause to believe in the first instance. And if they get reasonable cause to believe, there's evidence, isn't there? Why was that evidence not used? Mm-hmm. And why were those police officers the PIRC investigating these crimes, why are they not charged? What's happened? The Crown and the police know about this now, and these guys are walking free. Absolutely shocking. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's very interesting. Goodness me. Can it just on a follow-on question, again sticking with former officers? I'm interested in what you think about the intention to allow proceedings against former officers to commence or to continue. The timescale that's put on is up to 12 months after an officer has left the force, unless according to the bill, specific criteria are met. Do you have any view on that?
A crime's a crime. It shouldn't be time-barred. This should be all the time. It should depend on the seriousness and the effect that they had on the people or their persons or their, I don't know, property.
Mm-hmm. OK, thanks for that. No. So no time limit on that. That should not be time limited.
No. Yeah. No, definitely not. No way. Yeah.
OK, thank you for that. I'm going to bring in John Swinney now.
Hi, John.
Thank you very much, Kavir. Good afternoon, Ms. Robertson. Can I just ask you've made a really powerful case about the need for what I might call as a significant hurricane of fresh air into this system. And I just, you've obviously seen the bill that we have before us. And, am I right to deduce from that you don't think that bill is adequate to address the degree of scrutiny and transparency that is required of the system, given your experience?
Yeah, given my experience, we need to have, as I say, another mind, another culture create this. I don't know who, but not the current one. And we do need to have transparency all the way through. Transparency should be given as a statement of fact throughout, never be requested. It should be there. That should be that. But I'm not so sure how it would go.
See, I think you pose a, you know, a significant challenge to the committee, because you know, you've marshalled your arguments really powerfully in front of the committee today, but it raises a huge question about the transparency of actions and the confidence that members of the public and this committee can have in the culture of the police force and those who scrutinise the police force as being essentially built around that principle of transparency. And I just wonder if you've got any further thoughts you could share with us about how we might strengthen the provisions in front of us to address the concerns that you've expressed today.
Never voluntary to have somebody come in and audit, someone highly paid, someone who can be proud of their job, and somebody not given bonus as such. Somebody who's honourable, who's got integrity, maybe perhaps somebody from the military. Someone who understands the process and someone who also understands what's cut the wheat from the chaff, what's important, what's not so important, and what and how it can affect people. Someone who understands that when, on a psychological level, who they're dealing with, are they telling the truth, are they not telling the truth, are they hiding something? So I'd be looking for ex-military, ex-Navy, people like that, maybe fire brigade, someone like that. That's the team that I would be looking for, or maybe something like that, rather than some people we can trust.
Okay.
People are honourable. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, thanks, Mina, and good afternoon, Maggie. Thanks very much for your evidence so far. I was wanting to ask a question a wee bit from the other side of the discussion that we've had today, and because I think that all of our contributors today have came to us with really quite serious cases and how you've been impacted. And thank you again for bringing that to the committee in the way that you've done it. But all of you have at some point as well acknowledged that the seriousness of concerns will be on some sort of line from very low to very high. How do you think, if we're making changes here and we want to get that independence right, how do you think we can quickly identify complaints that are less serious and can be dealt and can be dealt with quickly to prevent any system becoming overwhelmed? And why I ask that is because, you know, almost anybody could have a complaint about the minute police are in their lives, could have some sort of complaint. And not all of them will be as serious as those that you've expressed and your fellow contributors have expressed today. Have you had any thoughts on how we might be able to do that? Because what we wouldn't want to create is a system that gets clogged up quickly. And obviously, in other matters outside of this committee session, we've been speaking about particular bills that have been brought through and too many complaints have been into the police in initial weeks. So, you know, we don't want police officers or any other organisations' time taken up, and then we want them to be concentrating on cases like yourselves, cases like Stephanie's. We want them to be concentrating on that. Have you got any ideas? Sorry if it's a wee bit out of the blue, that question.
No.
But any ideas how we quickly get to that stage?
But what you're talking about is you don't want any bottleneck there. That's what you're speaking about. I don't want a bottleneck, and I want to be able to categorise so we can quickly sift. Why can't that be done? What is causing a bottleneck to stopping a bottleneck? Why isn't it categorised? I think there should be a categorisation. There should be, depending on the people as well. So if you've got an OAP who really doesn't know how to operate the system or work the system and takes time, but they have got a really serious complaint against the police, maybe they had something there that wasn't investigation, it was a physical assault or something like that. Now, these people need to be dealt with differently than somebody else who's got a systematic complaint with the police. It's not really going to have an effect on them. It's not really going to affect them mentally, but it was more process-related. deal with it that way. Have it categorised, have it worked out. But allow the categorisation to change over time, because during the complaint, things can change. So look at it that way. Don't allow the bottlenecks. Deal with it. Who is it is complaining? What are they complaining with? What about? Allow the officer to highlight to another team or teams where this should go. Okay.
Thank you.
Offer apologies first off in the offset as well. Allow the police to be able to apologise. That might solve a lot of issues without having to go into full big going on complaints.
Okay, thank you. Thank Maggie, you. We're just coming to the end of the session. I wonder if I can just ask you another final question. It's not in the bill, but it does relate to PERC, which we've spoken about at length this morning. Now, the bill does expand some of the functions of the PERC in terms of complaints, and it does allow a sort of further broadening of their role within this misconduct process. Do you feel that there's sufficient oversight of PERC and in their role currently and the role that they fulfil currently? And do you feel anything further is required if they are given further powers? And I know you, to a certain extent, you really articulated that already this morning, but if there's anything further that you feel you'd like to add on that.
Okay, I'm going to come back right out with a question that not deliberately, not to trick you, but you'll understand. So on the 28th of May, Ian Packer was convicted and police apologised for their handling of the case. On the 28th, I went back to Burke and says, hi, given police have apologised, given they've admitted liability, would you please consider opening up my case for complaint again? It was ignored. I went back on the 6th of March. It was ignored. I went back on the 8th of March. It was ignored. We're nearly hitting, 7 weeks after that. And guess what? They've still ignored it. So we need somebody to make sure that PERC does their job. Where do I go? Mm-hmm. I've got nowhere to go. Mm-hmm. So there is no governing body for PERC. It's mates and people who know each other, who can grease each other's hands and help their mates out. That's what we have here. Because I've still got nowhere to go with this complaint. What I need to do is take civil action against these police at my own cost and need to fund it myself. That's what I need to do if I want justice.
Okay, thank you, Maggie. I think on that very powerful final note, I'm just going to bring the session to an end, but just put...
Yes, thank you.
Hand it back to you in case there's any further final, very final point that you want to make.
Me? Yeah. What's happened is with the police and PERC have managed to set up a perfect situation where they can protect themselves against the public. The public that have been victimised against them is absolutely ridiculous. It sounds like something out of a science fiction novel. It doesn't appear to be true because it doesn't sound true. But yet, here we are, and it's true. You believe it? Oh, my goodness. Let's scrap all this nonsense about giving them another list to create. Let's start charging these people that have committed these crimes within PERC, and the people that are in the police that have helped grease their hands need to be the action needs to be taken against them. These guys are criminals.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to pull the session to a close. Thank you for joining us this morning, Maggie. It has been really valuable to hear from you. We're grateful for your time. So with that concludes the public part of today's meeting, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thanks for your time. Bye-bye.